think, let's talk about promoting a book. Mm-hmm. How do you promote a book?
Yeah.
I imagine that's like 90% of it. I don't know about 90, but like you write the book and then like promoting is the trick.
Yeah. I mean, if you build it, they will not come. Yeah. You have to tell them about it. And it's the classic, it's like, man, this is why I went through your stuff early on in the copywriting course. I know I've told you this before, but copywriting course is like one of the first online courses that I ever took, and also I want to say definitely the first copywriting course that I ever took. But mm-hmm. it's because I got there as a result of failing and coming to a couple mentors of mine, and I'm like, hey, what am I doing wrong? And they're like, Chandler, you got to learn sales and marketing. That's what you're doing wrong. And it's the classic, well, hold up, I don't like sales and marketing. And they said, it doesn't matter if you like it, you got to learn it, because mm-hmm. you're not going to sell books. Your business is going to struggle if you don't learn this skill set. And so then it was, okay, what is copywriting, salesmanship in print, being able to use the written word to sell things? And then where does copywriting show up? Everywhere. It's in the title, it's in the subtitle, it's in the way that we structure this the cover of a book, it's in the book description, it's in the, you know, it's the classic, like, the job of the cover is to get them to click into your Amazon listing.
The slippery slope concept.
Yeah, it's the slippery slope concept. But so then that's like ongoing marketing and building that into the book. But how do you promote a book? I'll just say there's a lot of ways to do it, but if you just do one thing, create a launch team. And so a launch team is, it could be 5 people, it could be 15 people, it could be 50 people. It's anyone who's supports you or the topic of your book. And you pull together a little, it could be friends, family members, customers, doesn't matter. And there's 2 sides of the coin. There's what they do and what they get, right? So what they do is they read the book ahead of time and leave a review on day one. That's the most important thing. And then what they get in return is they get a free digital copy of the book. I like to put their name in the digital copy of the book. People love that. And they get to see like kind of the behind the scenes of the launch. It's a cool thing that they get to be involved in. Mm-hmm. And obviously they can promote more than just leaving a review. But mm-hmm. for me, it's, I want to be super clear where it's like, if you just do that. So now all of a sudden when you're launching, you've got 5, 15, 50 reviews right out of the gates. And that really helps the Amazon algorithm say, oh, this is a book that people like. And it just, their search algorithm is very highly weighted towards reviews. So if you want to rank for keywords, if you want to all that stuff long-term, it's like you need reviews outside of all the other stuff that's obvious to us as marketers, like social proof, and no one's buying a book with 3 reviews. Yeah. So it's like you need reviews. And so if you just do one thing, do the launch team.
So you're talking about, it's like your brother, your mom, your dad, a part of your launch team, right?
I mean, depending on how big your audience is.
Yeah. I mean, let's say you're not Chandler Bolt to have an audience. Like, you're talking about like your buddies.
Oh yeah. For me, this was this was friends on Facebook. And I think my first launch team, I probably had maybe 50 to 70. And it was, I mean, reach outs, like, and it's like the classic, I will say, like, what the mistake most authors make is they come out of their hole on launch week and they're like, oh my gosh, guys, I'm launching a book. Yeah. Who wants to buy my book? And then it's just like for a week, they just beat everyone over the head with it. And then they go back in their cave. It's like, no one cares. This is the first I've heard of this. I'm not interested. And so instead, what I recommend is just involve people in the process. Mm. I mean, Hollywood has done this well, I feel like, for years, of just like the behind the scenes red carpet experience, where it's like leading up to it. I'm announcing that I'm writing. And so we like build this into the student journey, where it's like, we send them a surprise gift in the mail after they enroll. And like one of them is like this future published author sign, where mm-hmm. it's like they can put in a date, they can take a picture of it, post it. So it's like, that's public accountability for them. And it's building buzz towards the book. And then it's like, okay, what are all these milestones? And we're trying to build we've got like this book cover mock-up generator, where it's like you put in your book cover and it spits out a bunch of promotional images that mm-hmm. you can use that are pretty cool. But we're trying to take that, we haven't been able to pull it off yet, but take that to the next level, where it's like, okay, what are the 10 to 20 milestones that you want to celebrate as an author? And how do we allow you to upload your book cover, and it's like, oh, I got my first review, I got my first 50 reviews, hit the number one bestseller tag, like all these things. So it's like, how do you just involve people in the process? I'm thinking about, and you've probably seen people do this, and we kind of popularize this concept, but Voting on titles and voting on covers. It's just like, hey, what do you guys think of this book cover and which one's best, the title? Like, and so involving people in the process, and the people who engage, it's like, oh, hey, you want to be on my launch team? I'll give you a free copy of the book ahead of time.
You know, I think I inadvertently did this with this book. This book will teach you how to write better. I was doing all these, I was going to call it the 10 copywriting commandments. And it had a picture of like whoever the Noah guy, whatever the, not Christian. I don't know. Yeah. that Noah, the good Noah's Ark guy, he's holding the commandments, whoever that dude was. And he's holding up the 10 commandments, but it says 10 copywriting commandments. And I thought it was so clever. And so we tested it versus this book cover, and the copyright, the commandments thing just failed like crazy. It was like 90-10, like don't do that one, do this one. And this one was just a random cover. Someone that was helping me at the time just made it as like a placeholder. It wasn't meant to be like anything crazy.
And man, I mean, this, even just looking at this cover, I mean, this is the, I mean, this is what we teach. It's like a good book cover does three things. It grabs attention. Mm-hmm. The title is easy to read and is preferably in the upper third, right? Easy, very easy to read. And it's in the upper third. And then the third thing is, does your prospect or potential reader instantly understand what the book's about and whether or not it's for them?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this book will teach you how to write better is the title of the book.
Yeah.
I instantly understand.
Oh, look at the back too. It says you plus this book equals write better.
Which I think is, I mean, this is classic you and like classic your style of copywriting, but it's so effective. And then it's, this book is short, effective, and sort of offensive, but you will write better after reading it. So it's like, I read that and I'm like, oh, cool. I'm going to like this. And then communication is just getting information from one brain to another brain. Quote. It's like, okay, cool. Like I instantly understand what the book's about and whether or not it's for me. And either I'm going to say, oh no, offensive, I'm out, or offensive, that could be funny and make this topic more interesting. All right, I'm in for this. I want to learn how to write.
I always tell people, I always really strive to make sure that everyone's on the same page about something. Usually unhappiness is something like, if someone's like, I didn't like this course, it's just like they were expecting something and we didn't match up somehow.
It's unmet expectations.
So I was debating the like offensive thing. I was just like, well, I probably wouldn't say that again today, but 2013, I was like, I mean, there's some uncouth language in there. I may as well just say that.
Yeah.
So people are all on the same page. We're all on the same page over here. Okay.
Be specific about it.
Launch team. I like that thing. I did a bunch of, I did a lot of involvement on my blog with like this thing, like everything I learned, why I picked a 6x9 book. I actually copied it from Kamal Ravikant, Naval Ravikant's brother.
Mm-hmm.
I met him and he had a book called Love Yourself Like Your Life Depends on It.
Mm.
It was exactly this size and he sold it for $5, exactly what I did.
Mm.
And I got on the phone with him and I was asking him some questions and I was like, do you mind if I literally just copy everything you did, but about a different topic? He's like, I don't care. And so I literally modeled this book after that one. It was the exact same type of thing. I just liked it. It's like it was such a fair trade. I remember it was $5. I learned an interesting lesson and I was like, all right, money well spent.
Yeah.
It didn't take a lot of time.
Yeah.
I felt very like pleased by the transaction.
Mm.
So I always hope that.
Purchase his book.
Yeah. Like it wasn't like super up my alley, like loving yourself. Like I'm not really into all that kind of stuff, but I read it. It took me about 30 minutes and I was like, I got something out of that.
Yeah.
Cool.
It's great.
What more?
It's a beautiful thing. Everyone's about a book.
Yeah. He made some money. I paid a little bit of money. I got something out of it.
Yeah.
We're all happy.
It's great.
I really, really like that. What about promoting the book through like blogs and social? I imagine like people take to social media now and just start like hammering the book out. Does that work well or?
It does to a point. I mean, so I'm all about like rifle, not shotgun approach. And so, I mean, being from the South, I guess maybe this is worth explaining.
We're in Texas.
But you know, it's like when you shoot shotgun, it's a bunch of little BBs, sprays everywhere. You hope that you hit the target with some of them. Rifle that travels a long distance, extremely accurate. So for us, we're looking at the rifle approach to marketing. So, so there's a lot of stuff that you can do, but a handful of things that move the needle, those handful of things, I mean, there's, you know, launch team stuff. There's podcast interviews really move the needle. So it's like, I would be way more strategic about doing podcast interviews than I would be about guest posting for other blogs. And then there's other stuff like influencer stuff and getting people to post. And so, yeah, social can move the needle, but then it becomes a chicken and the egg. Like if I've got no audience, well, I'm just posting to no one.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, it's what I did with my first book was just engaging social, but mostly in the highest leverage way possible to get to like build buzz and bring people onto my launch team, and then one-on-one outreaches to like follow up for reviews and stuff like that.
Interesting. Yeah, we were just talking to Eamon, the CEO of AppSumo, and he was like, actually, social is the weakest channel that they have.
Oh, yeah.
They do it, and it's great, but social is the weakest channel by far.
Same for self-publishing school. We were talking about that right before the interview. It's like, yeah, we're not really on social a ton because it just doesn't drive a ton.
Well, because I look at like stuff, like some of your numbers don't add up, but I was looking at some of your numbers. It's like your YouTube channel has tons of subscribers.
Yeah, yeah.
Like pretty high for a YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. Your podcast, it has like hundreds of reviews.
Yeah.
So it sounds like that's a pretty big channel. We'll get into that in a second.
Like Twitter is like 5 people or something.
Twitter's like no one. Like I actually couldn't find you. I typed in Chandler Bolt author because I was like, I swear I follow you or something. And there's like some bald dude with the beard that shows up. It's not even you. You're not even like on there.
I personally do not have a Twitter or Instagram or anything besides Facebook. But then as a company, we technically have a Twitter. We are pretty, I don't think we post really.
But you're probably not selling a ton of books off that. No. Sounds, that's always kind of encouraging to hear whenever I hear it. Like someone, I was just like, oh, they only have 800 followers. But then you're like, oh, they have $100 million company. You're like,
yes.
Wait a second. Like, oh, social media is not real life sometimes.
And it's stylistically, right? Like, we could build a business around that. But for me, I've just always ran away from that kind of stuff. I'm like, I don't want to be dependent on social or on posting on social as a way of living. Cause then I'm living life to, I don't know, this is a bit of a soapbox, but then I'm living life to grab the picture to be able to sell this thing and like constantly feeling like I've got to post everything about my life to like drum up business, which I don't know, works for some people. Some people love it, but it's just not me.